Vuyo, Luca, welcome. Vuyo, to you first. Sasol have made some firm climate commitments. Would you just talk to me a little bit about them?
Thanks, Georgie. We certainly have made firm commitments. They include cutting our greenhouse gas emissions by 30% by 2030 off our 2017 baseline. And that really is focused around the scope 1 and scope 2 emissions, cutting our scope 3 emissions in that period by 20%, and really focusing ourselves on the ultimate ambition of being net zero by 2050. So that's essentially what the targets are. And we do believe, especially when one is regards to our business and the carbon intensity, particularly of the South African value chain, that these are significant. And we have already been working over time, because if you take going back to 2004, we've already cut 11 million tons of CO2 off our operations in South Africa. And so with that in mind, we do believe that we can be confident about attaining the objectives we've set ourselves in respect of 2030 and ultimately 2050.
Confidence, an important word. Broaden it out, if you would, for me, Luca, to the transition in South Africa more generally. Is there confidence that this is achievable?
Well, South Africa is not short of challenges, for sure. But having worked with a coalition of 30 companies in South Africa to unpack what a net zero pathway could look like, I have to say South Africa is also not short of capabilities, both people and companies. And we need to acknowledge that this is a transition. So to phase out coal, we also need to scale up alternative solutions, the proven ones in the short term, renewables, biofuels, some gas as well, and start scaling up progressively the early stage green tech, like green hydrogen, PTX, SAF. And there we see really incredible potential in South Africa and incredible capability. If we take the example of Sasol with 70 years of engineering capabilities in upgrading molecules and producing synthetic fuels with Fischer Tropsch. So we do believe there are actually a great potential in South Africa to achieve this.
Well, if you would, just talk to me through a few more of the projects that are helping you achieve your climate ambitions.
I think the first point, Georgie, to raise in relation to our 2030 targets, I mean, we've been focused around bringing in renewables. We believe that renewables would contribute about 6% of that 30%. Equally, energy efficiencies, really just bringing efficiencies in our processes, including a reduction in the usage of coal, will add another 12% to getting us to that 30%. And of course, they equally will be a focus around boiler 10 downs, bring in another 12%. So we've got a clear plan around how we can go about this in respect of 2030. Doesn't make it easy. It's a challenging environment, looking into affordability and all that, but we do believe that there are clear plans that could lead us into attaining those objectives.
Luca, can you tell me more about how companies are financing the transition in South Africa?
George, this is an excellent question, particularly in the context of the Global South. Some of the companies in the Global South have much more challenged balance sheet compared to the Global North. And so it is with the countries themselves who cannot put in place incentive mechanisms like we have in the US or the European Union. So we need mechanisms beyond JETPs. We need more grants, we need carbon credits, and we need, more importantly, offtakes from more advanced economies to the Global South in the places where the premium can be afforded in early stages. Vuyo, how is it at Sasol?
Well, in respect of Sasol, firstly, our focus is on using our own resources in respect of the period leading to 2030. And that calls on us really getting our current foundation business operating more efficiently to generate the capital we require to invest. But also, of course, we do need an appropriate carbon pricing regime in South Africa that can equally enable us to make the investments that we intend to make.